Hello, I am at the historic Cashtown Inn here in Cashtown, Pennsylvania. Gettysburg is 5 miles east. This place was founded in 1797 as a stagecoach stop, and in its biggest claim to fame, though, comes during the Battle of Gettysburg. In 1863, as the Confederates were moving through Pennsylvania, their first target was Harrisburg, then they were going to maybe go for Philadelphia and hopefully go down to Washington, D.C. and force an end to the war, which would have been Southern independence. Lieutenant General A.P. Hill, commander of Robert E. Lee's 3rd Corps, used this building as his headquarters during the campaign as his forces were moving past it. On the morning of July 1st, 1863, Robert E. Lee and A.P. Hill met out front because there was a little skirmish starting about 5 miles east at some little crossroads town nobody really ever heard of, but Lee was trying to figure out what was going on. And that right there is significant. A commanding general is trying to figure out what was going on. He had specifically said he didn't want a general engagement brought on, but a general engagement was developing. Of course, that's the Battle of Gettysburg's beginning, and that was 160 years ago tomorrow morning. So I'm here for the 160th anniversary of the Battle of Gettysburg. Now, I did not bring my studio equipment with me, even my field gear, because I'm here to see what's going on, see the reenactments, just be here for the 160th. Obviously, I'll be filming and taking pictures, but the formal travel logs will be coming in a few weeks, a couple weeks, I should say. In the meantime, though, I'll do some small little updates like this just to kind of give you some little trivial pieces, including the Cashtown Inn. This place is a working bed and breakfast. I actually stayed here 13 years ago. It's a really nice place to stay. It's worth it, but you need to make sure you book early because it's a small place. Back in 1797, even 1863, and probably have plenty of rooms because you didn't have a whole lot of travelers. Well, this is the 21st century in 2023. It gets busy here, especially with Gettysburg being a major tourist draw. So, anyway, as they said back in the days of the 6 o'clock news, further bulletins as events warrant, and film at 11. Peace out, and remember, go do great things. Good morning. It is July 1st, 2023. 160 years ago today, on July 1st, 1863, the Battle of Gettysburg began. This was the biggest battle ever to happen here on the North American continent. So, yesterday, of course, I was at the Cashtown Inn, and normally when I come to Gettysburg, I usually came up from the south and just kind of by accident follow the route the Union Army took. It's a little bit of common trivia, but it is a little fun that the Union Army, the Northern Army, came into Gettysburg from the south, while the Confederate Army, the Southern Army, came in from the north. Yesterday, because I was coming from seeing friends in Tennessee, I came up and ended up following the route the Confederate Army of Northern Virginia took, and that was one of the stops was the Cashtown Inn. So I'm heading out, gonna get this started by going to the National Park Service Visitor Center. Well, it's run by the Gettysburg Foundation in partnership with the Park Service. Very good museum. If you ever come up here, go see it. But make sure you get in town. There's a lot in town, and a lot of people don't realize the battlefield is not just the field that the Park Service maintains. Gettysburg was the site of some horrific urban fighting the afternoon of July 1st and all day July 2nd. So, alrighty. Well, I will be on later, and I hope y'all have a great day. Until I see you in a couple hours, go do some great things. All right, I'm here at the home of Ephraim Whistler. He was a blacksmith. Behind me, you can see the first shot marker where the Battle of Gettysburg began. Union cavalry was about a mile to the east in Gettysburg, and that was under the command of General John Buford. Well, the 8th Illinois Cavalry was right here as an advanced picket line, or an advance guard to keep an eye out for enemy forces, because they knew the Confederates were somewhere out west. This is the Chambersburg Road. Even in 1863, this was a major road. Of course, it wasn't quite as crowded or loud as it is now. Their job, like I said, was to watch for enemy forces. They saw the Confederates of General Henry Heath's division coming up this road. They sent a message to General Buford, alerting him that enemy forces were approaching. Then one of the officers borrowed a carbine from a sergeant, set it on a fence rail that used to exist right here,
and took a pot shot at the Confederates. That one shot is what started the biggest battle of the Civil War, the biggest battle ever on North American soil. What that shot did was it stopped the Confederates from just marching swiftly toward town and forced them to deploy what's called a skirmish line, where they put skirmishers out front in a wide sweeping formation to go through the brush, the woods, to come slowly up the road in order to fight the Union picket line. Well, the 8th Illinois Cavalry actually fell back, joined the Union Cavalry, and started a series of holding actions. But that one shot started the delay of the Confederates, allowing Union forces time to start getting come to Gettysburg from further east. So this is where it all began, about 7:30 in the morning on July 1st, 1863.
Hey y'all, well, it is nightfall, July 1st. I just walked back in the door of my hotel room, and either it started raining on me as I was walking back, or else the Park Service left the sprinklers on. It's been a good day. Saw the first marker, saw the first shot marker here. Just had dinner at the Dobbins House Tavern. That place was built in 1776. It's the oldest structure here in Gettysburg. It is today operated as a bed and breakfast and a tavern. You have a nice fine dining area in the main house and then the tavern down in the basement. And both are historic, all of it dates from 1776. Great food, just make sure you either eat during the off hours or put your name on the list and don't be afraid to wait. It's very popular. It is expensive, it's fine dining, even now in the tavern, but totally worth it. Not sure what's gonna happen tomorrow. Last night I attended a ghost tour. It was a demonstration of ghost hunting techniques. One tool they use is a laser-like grid. They'll darken the room, use this laser-like grid on the wall, and what it does is in the dark, sometimes with visible light, but usually with infrared or other electronic means, that lets you see if something passes by that grid. Well, last night the gentleman, and this was at the Farnsworth house, lays me right in the face. He had the thing turned too far over where I was sitting, and boom. Now, they were very apologetic. I got to give credit where due. They were very concerned. They tried to get me medical attention. I didn't need it. I've actually been lasered in the face before with low power lasers. It's not good. It is dangerous, but my left eyeball still burned for several hours last night. I'm fine now. Then today I was talking to some Confederate reenactors at a cannon battery they were maintaining. I was talking to one reenactor, didn't realize it, neither did he, because I'm looking at the cannon's 30 feet back there. I'm looking at him, he's looking at me, we're talking. They fired off the cannon for a demonstration. I hit the deck and uttered a few explicatives that would have made my brothers and sisters in the chief petty officer mess very proud of me. Gotta wonder though, last night I get lased in the face. Today I have a cannon shot off unexpectedly 30 feet behind me. What the hell is gonna happen tomorrow? All right, short wrap up here. It's the end of July 1st, 2023. July 1st, 1863, sun is falling. Union forces and Confederate forces are mashed up here. During the day, the Union was pushed through town onto Cemetery Hill and Cemetery Ridge. This hotel I'm in is built on Cemetery Hill. And it's called that because literally outside my window, and I'll show you this later, is Evergreen Cemetery, the civilian cemetery that's been here since 1854. Beyond that is the grounds that were used for the National Cemetery. But I'm looking at a cemetery right now out that window. It's a hill, it's a high ground. The Confederates didn't push all the way through and take it. However, that wasn't the critical mistake today. North of town is Culp's Hill. Had the Confederates taken that today, the battle wouldn't have happened. The problem was one of Robert E. Lee's generals was dilatory and showed no urgency in getting Culp's Hill. He was kind of a McClellan, if you know the reference from our General McClellan early in the Civil War on our side. He was afraid of failure. He was afraid to take chances. And therefore, the Union forces got up on Culp's Hill and started digging in. The Confederates didn't try and take it until basically right now, about 8 o'clock at night. The fighting finally ends at 10 p.m. There's no lights, no flashlights, no infrared, no night vision. This is 1863. Soldiers fought by muzzle flash, but then you have all the smoke concealing that. Soldiers on both sides pin pieces of paper on their back, not with their names, although that does happen, and that's what starts our dog tags. It was so their fellows could see them in the dark. Had the Confederates taken that hill, battle wouldn't have happened. It would have moved elsewhere because the Union would not have been able to entrench along a series of ridges and hills from Culp's Hill across Cemetery Hill, where I am, all the way down to the Round Tops, which we'll see tomorrow. That was the first major mistake. Not taking Cemetery Hill during the day was a mistake, but not getting Culp's Hill was a critical error on their part. And on our part, General Meade, who's commanding our forces, his forces took it. He had some good generals at that, running that end of his battle. They took it, held it for the Union. Therefore, tomorrow, July 2nd, kind of became a guarantee that the fight was going to stay here. But I'm going to get a shower, get all this done, and then I'm going to relax for the night, and I'm going to start watching 1993's movie Gettysburg. It's about 4 hours, so I'll be doing it in stages over the next few nights. But until we talk tomorrow, have a great night, and as always, go do some great things. Thanks, Elvis. Hey, y'all. Well, it is July 2nd, 2023. Day two of the Battle of Gettysburg was 160 years ago today, obviously, because I'm here. It is pretty rainy and goopy outside, just like it was yesterday. We've had a storm system moving across the United States, plus a lot of haze and smoke from wildfires up in Canada coming down. Haven't got a lot of sweeping scenic shots of the battlefield because, frankly, it's gray and kind of bleh. And in photography terms, bleh is a technical term. When I do my big travel logs in a couple weeks after I'm back in Florida, what I'm probably going to do for any sweeping landscape shots that I want to share about the story, I'll pull footage from my visit in 2021 during the 158th anniversary because at least the sky was clear and you can see the field and all the details without haze obscuring them. If I do that, of course, I'll note it clearly on the video that you're watching footage from back then while I tell the stories, but that's in the future. It is gonna be pretty rainy today, especially this afternoon, so I'm not sure how much hiking or anything I'm gonna get to do, but I'm not giving up. Also, the Park Service has been doing a lot of renovations and work on the south end of the field. Devil's Den and Little Round Top might actually still be closed because there's been problems with erosion largely caused by people walking off designated paths and just cutting, basically blazing their own trails, and that causes erosion. And also just the facilities were built decades ago. The tourism numbers have increased, so some of the facilities are just flat out overwhelmed. Going to be interesting, but we'll see. Either way, it's still the 160th anniversary. I'm going to go get some coffee. And we're going to start this adventure. So I will see y'all when I see you. Go do some great things. Well, welcome aboard Sarah Jane, my trusty car. I'm here at Little Round Top and Devil's Den. Little Round Top is right there to my left. Devil's Den is ahead of me. It's funny, in a place like this, when you say some of the fiercest, most bloody fighting of the war and of the battle happened here, it starts to lose its meaning. Because this place was such a bloodbath overall. There are some accounts from soldiers and civilians just, during and after the battle that talked about places where the ground was muddy, but muddy with blood. Still, Little Round Top was made extremely famous by the 1993 movie Gettysburg for a reason. The Confederates were trying to take it, and if they had, they could have destroyed the entire Union line. Desperate battle happened here, and it came down to the wire, but the Union prevailed. However, unfortunately, we can't get up onto Little Round Top directly, not just for this little short, but for the whole thing, because it is closed. They are, like I said earlier, they are renovating it, and they were not able to open it for this anniversary. But I'll get to that later. There's two other places specifically on the field I'm going to look at today and mention. The wheat field, which is where the entire Union effort almost got decimated because one Union general was kind of an arrogant Burke, and then Culp's Hill, which was the other hill that saved the Union line on July 2nd. I'm on the top of Culp's Hill. Culp's Hill is at the north end of Gettysburg, and this is the hill I was talking about yesterday. Had Confederate forces taken this hill yesterday during the day before the Union could start building up and entrenching on it, the battle would never have happened here. That doesn't mean the Union would have lost. That doesn't mean Lee's Gettysburg campaign would have been successful. It doesn't mean that. It just means the fighting would have ended up somewhere else. But the Confederate forces that were on this end of the battle didn't
take it until the Union was entrenched. And so last night they fought at night. It was fierce, but the Union held. They're going to fight again tonight, and the Union's going to hold. So you had a little Round Top on the south end today. It's very famous, deservedly so. Then tonight, Culp's Hill, kind of the same thing happens. Lee could have taken this town had he gotten this hill yesterday, but he didn't. So the battle continues on, and that's going to eventually lead us, of course, into the great and awful Pickett's Charge tomorrow. But I will talk to y'all soon. I'm going to go walk around and get sweaty because it's only, like I said, mid-80s right now because of all the cloud cover. But the humidity really is murder. I mean, this is, it's more humid right now than Florida is, and that's saying something. So catch y'all soon. Hey, all. Welcome back to Sarah Jane. It is the evening time. Let's see what it is. It's 8:13 p.m. here on July 2nd, 2023. It's been a very good day. Weather broke. We were supposed to have storms and everything all day. It has turned into a glorious day. Spent most of the day downtown. And remember in yesterday's video, I said I wonder what the hell is going to happen today. Because day one, when I got here on the 30th, I got lazed in the face. Yesterday, I had a cannon unexpectedly shot off 30 feet behind me and scared me out of about 10 years growth. Well, I found out what the hell was going to happen today, because what the hell was going to happen today happened. Only this was something really good. When Abraham Lincoln, President Lincoln, came to Gettysburg to give the Gettysburg Address, he stayed in the home of local attorney David Wills. Mr. Wills was a very prominent Gettysburg resident, Adams County resident, I should say. And Mr. Wills is the man who conceived of and spearheaded the movement that got the National Cemetery created. Edward Everett, of course, was invited to speak, and he gave a two-hour oration. Contrary to legend, when Mr. Lincoln was invited, people didn't expect him to come, not because they thought he was a buffoon and a baboon or anything. It was because in those days, the president really never traveled very much. And there was a war on that Mr. Lincoln had to run. So it was a surprise when he came, but only because they didn't think he'd have the time. So he comes to Gettysburg on November 18th, 1863, stays in Mr. Wills' house, and on November 19th, 1863, the cemetery is dedicated and the Gettysburg Address is delivered. What does this have to do with having a good day? This is my 30th year coming to Gettysburg. I've been coming to Gettysburg for 30 years now. My first time was in 1993 when I was on spring break. I was a junior at Florida State and did a Civil War trek, and this was the last stop before turning around and heading back to Florida. So I've been coming to Gettysburg for 30 years. But I've never been inside the David Wills house. For 30 years, every time I came here, it was closed. Today, I got inside the David Wills house. Today, for me personally, I was able to finally complete the Gettysburg Address pilgrimage, if you will. All the major sites that Mr. Lincoln hit or was at for the Gettysburg Address, I've now actually not just been at, but been in. I've been in the room now where Mr. Lincoln slept and worked on finishing the speech. Again, legend says he wrote it on an envelope in the train, polished it here. Nope, he didn't. He wrote it in Washington. He polished it on the train with Secretary of State Seward and his secretaries, and then did his final notes here. But Mr. Lincoln was a very deliberate writer. Being in the room that he slept in and the room in which he finished his final notes, his final polishing, was really something. This trip for me is 10 years in the making. I was here for the 150th in 2013, and I promised myself I'd be back for the 160th, so here I am. But being able to finally step inside the David Wills house, I've been waiting to do that for 30 years. So that alone made today a spectacular success, even if nothing else did. But it's time, it's 8:17 p.m. now. Gotta go upstairs, take a shower, get this put together so I can get it out to you guys, and then watch the next part of the movie Gettysburg before I fall asleep. I will see y'all tomorrow, and until we do meet again, as I always say, go do some great things. Good night. Good morning. It is July 3rd, 2023. Today is the final day of the commemoration of the Battle of Gettysburg. 160 years ago today, the whole thing came crashing to a halt. Everybody is familiar with Pickett's Charge, the great and final catastrophic charge releasing tens of thousands of men in a mile-wide long formation against the center of the Union line, and got his clock cleaned. I'm a Southerner. I did grow up revering Lee, but as a retired chief petty officer, as a military man, I have to look at the evidence, and Lee was a great leader. He could inspire. He could get people to follow him. But in my opinion, he was not a great general. He was very hands-off. He rarely, if ever, put anything in writing. And if you don't put something in writing, your generals are free to interpret, assuming they even get the verbal order correct. So he sets up a complex battle plan for today to once again hit the Union right and left, the Round Tops and Culp's Hill. He's also going to send his cavalry commander, Jeb Stuart, to hit the Union rear at the same time that Pickett's charge is hitting the Union front. Because he didn't put things in writing, because he didn't send aides all over the place to make sure his generals were commencing operations when he wanted, and because he would go stay in one place, watch the battle, but not actually go back and forth himself either to see what's happening, his whole plan just fell apart. The attacks on the inns, on the hills, didn't happen anywhere near when he needed them to. The cavalry charge, the cavalry attack, might have worked. Jeb Stuart got around 5 miles east of here behind the Union line, but he was stopped by Union cavalry. So that left Pickett's charge going directly into the center of an army that would have stopped it anyway, but now could mass truly overwhelming force and not just defeat Lee, but permanently decimate his army. It would still take 2 years for the war to end, or a year and a half for the war to end. No, it would be 2 years. But there was no way Lee could ever mount an offensive after this because he destroyed his army. But I have a fondness for the lesser known stories, hence me spending so much time on Culp's Hill yesterday. Because all that fighting both days on July 1st and 2nd happened at night, a lot of people don't even know about it. So I'm heading over to the East Cavalry Field, and it's a goopy day again. Hopefully it'll break like it did yesterday, but if it doesn't, I'll pull footage from 2021 to show you all that later when I do the big travel log. Excuse me. But that's a very significant part of this fight a lot of people don't know about, and it doesn't help that that battlefield for the East Cavalry Field is 5 miles east of here, and it's not contiguous with the town or the National Park Service land here. Let's get this adventure started and go do some great things. Alrighty, we are at the East Cavalry Field. Now at 11 a.m. on July 3rd, 1860, the Confederate cavalry, under the command of James Ewell Brown Stuart, or Jeb Stuart, came racing across this field in an attempt to hit the Union line's rear, scare the hell out of them, splinter them, soften them up, so when Pickett's charge began at 1 p.m., the Union line would be fractured, broken, higgledy-piggledy. That's not a military term, by the way. And Lee would win, destroy the Union Army of the Potomac, and the Civil War is the Confederates. Until this point in time, Jeb Stuart was the greatest and most successful cavalry commander here in the Eastern Theater of the War. He literally ran circles around the Union Army a couple of times. Figuratively, he ran circles around them a lot. That all began to change here. Union cavalry under General David Gregg intercepted Stuart's forces here on this field. It was a pitched battle. It was a close thing, but a seemingly reckless charge by a blonde-haired Union colonel under General Gregg caught the Confederates so off guard, because it seemed like such a suicidal maneuver, nobody would do it. All of a sudden, here are this colonel and his men come doing it. It splintered the Confederate cavalry's lines and basically started a rout that forced them off the field and kept the rear of the Union line safe. Had Stuart succeeded here and gotten through to the Union lines, odds are it would not have changed the outcome of the battle. General Meade still had forces to spare. He still had units of the Army of the Potomac coming into Gettysburg today. That's how big the Union Army was. That's how big the Union Army was. But it would have been a very different story. Although I already criticized General Lee's battle plans and control of his army earlier, one thing I will say in his defense, again, as a military man, in this time frame in the 19th century, there was no radio communication, there were no cell phones. So when this attack failed, Lee had absolutely no idea. he probably still would have ordered Pickett's charge, because he admitted on July 4th and July 5th, he admitted this was all my fault. He later admitted he thought he was on the right side. He thought he was on the winning side. He legitimately thought his army, the Army of Northern Virginia, was invincible. So a lot of things changed here at Gettysburg because of the Union victories. But even if this had succeeded, odds are it would not have changed the outcome of the battle. Oh, in case you're wondering about who that seemingly reckless yet heroic Union colonel was, he went on to fame, or should I say infamy, a few years later during the Indian Wars. He was a young braggart named George Armstrong Custer. All right, we're here at Pickett's Charge Field. It is just before 2 p.m. Now, at 1 p.m., on July 3rd, 1863, the Confederates started their cannonade. It was the biggest cannonade ever on North American soil. They bombarded the Union line for an hour. Now, the funny thing was, the cannon traces, which is the backside of the cannon that hooks on the cart, and also, is the cannon's tail that sits on the ground, started digging in the ground, and there was so much smoke that the Confederate cannoneers couldn't see and to aim properly, and actually started overshooting the Union forces. So they were hitting the Union, the soldiers that were resting in the Union rear from fighting yesterday were now getting shelled. The Union fired back for a little bit, but then General Meade realized that cannonade was clearly preceding an infantry charge. So Union forces stopped firing. The Confederates thought that the Union guns were destroyed. They thought that it meant the Union line was fractured. Right about now, at 2 p.m., Lee's great grand debacle. Pickett's charge steps off, starts walking across a mile of open ground to hit the Union front. When they're about halfway across, the Union cannons open up and start punching giant bloody holes in their line. They get closer, all the Union troops they thought were decimated by their own cannonade stand up and start blowing them away. It was still a pitched battle. A small number of Confederates got into the Union line, but were quickly captured or killed. And that is how the Battle of Gettysburg came crashing to a conclusion. Well, there it is. Pickett's charge is done. And that's actually a misnomer, the name Pickett. It was actually James Longstreet who was in command. Pickett was one of the division commanders. The three division commanders that made the charge. His division was pretty much wiped out. After the Confederate stragglers got back to Confederate lines, Pickett ran into Robert E. Lee, and General Lee says, "General Pickett, you must look to your division." Pickett's reply was, "General Lee, I have no division." Pickett hated Lee with a passion the rest of his life. They ran into each other, I forget what the function was, but it was a few years after the war, and very cold meeting. Afterward, Pickett said of Lee, "That old man had my division murdered at Gettysburg." Lee got caught up in his own invincibility, and he even admitted it later. He admitted he thought he was invincible. He admitted he thought the army could do the superhuman because they'd been so successful for so long. But the battle wasn't over. Yes, it was crashed. The main part of it had now crashed to a conclusion. But there was an expectation the Union was going to counterattack. The Confederates were bracing for it, but a lot of Union commanders were too. General Alfred Pleasanton ordered his cavalry to attack the Confederates down south of the field near Little Round Top. This is known as the South Cavalry Field, and I can't take you there because it's part of what's being renovated. But it was one of the most, it was like Pickett's charge was in its way. This was one of the most boneheaded maneuvers of the war. Pleasanton ordered a cavalry charge across land strewn with boulders and rocks and fallen trees and woods. Everything that you can't successfully run a horse through. It was a minor disaster, and that is where Farnsworth was killed, who the Farnsworth House is now named after. Why didn't General Meade counterattack and take out Lee? And Lincoln even was very, very furious with Meade for that. But the problem was Meade had been a corps commander until 3 days before this battle. The previous commander, Joe Hooker, had gotten into a huff and threatened to resign. Lincoln, tired of him, took him up on it, kicked him out, put Meade in command. Meade didn't even know what he had. He'd been in command for 3 days, and he's already fighting the biggest battle of the war. He didn't know where half his people were. He didn't even know who half his people were, because as a corps commander, he didn't need to. Yet he still won, because unlike Lee, Meade maintained control of his army as best as he could. Actively, Meade was all over the field inside the Union lines all 3 days, running himself ragged, seeing for himself what was going on. He had his aides carrying orders back and forth all the time, constantly. It wasn't like, just go tell him to do something. Go tell him to do this, come back and report. Go there. He maintained control, so he won. But he was as disorganized in victory as Lee was in defeat. The difference was, of course, he'd won. He was not in a position to attack. Now, 160 years later, it's easy for us to say that. It really is. At the time, he was heavily criticized, and that's one reason why the historical record has been very unkind to him. But the reality was, the Union Army, the Army of the Potomac, was shattered, partly by wounds and the dead and wounded, partly just by the fact that for 3 days, units have been scrambling and getting thrown all around the field because, again, Meade was moving all around the field, moving positions, and he didn't care if you were part of the Second Corps, if the Fourth Corps needed you. By the way, I'm making those turns up, but he found a Second Corps unit that wasn't being engaged. The Fourth Corps needed it. He moved you to the Fourth Corps just to shore up that part of the line. So the whole army had to get back into position. He was still slow. I'm not going to pull a punch on this one. He was still very slow in his pursuit because, like a lot of the Eastern generals, he was very cautious, especially after being clocked by Robert E. Lee for over 2 years. But Meade does not get the credit he deserves. When Lee, in the morning, attacked the Union left at Little Round Top of the Union right, up on Culp's Hill, Meade realized Lee had one target. It was going to be his center. If Lee's thrown all these forces back and forth at the ends, where is the logical place to strike? Well, Lee's expecting that Meade has shifted forces from the center to meet all those attacks on the side. And Meade had done a lot of that, but Meade had also kept a lot of forces in reserve to protect his center. So when Pickett's charge came, they walked into a wall of fire, lead, and steel. It is late. I'm hot. I've been turning and burning for a couple of days now. I am going to go shower and take a very long nap, and then I'll get back to it tonight. So, hey, well, good evening. It is just about 11 o'clock, or for my fellow military types, 2300 on July 3rd, 2023. I just got done doing a walking tour with, in this case, Gettysburg Ghost Tours. They're one of a number of companies here in town that do paranormal tours. I mean, I mentioned I went on one at the Farnsworth House the night I got here on the 30th. I personally love ghost tours, but I'm not recommending doing a ghost tour right now for ghost stories. And I'm not specifically endorsing Gettysburg Ghost Tours or any of the other companies. But one of the reasons I fell in love with ghost tours, and the first one I ever did was here in Gettysburg around 2009 or 10, so it was a while ago. If you want to do a good ghost tour, be it at Gettysburg or anywhere, here's some things I think you should look for. The first is, does the tour guide, when they're telling the stories, do they just talk about the ghosts, the paranormal experiences, the weird things that go on? Or do they actually bring up the humanity? Do they talk about the people whose lives were real and cut short by war or horribly impacted by war? Do they go into the details of life back then? For example, I did my master's in the Civil War, specifically on John Brown, but I learned more about Civil War surgery from the very first ghost tour I ever took, which was here in Gettysburg, than I ever did in the classroom. A good ghost tour will give you a lot of local history that you don't get anywhere else. So if you're looking for a good ghost tour, find one that will also go into the people stories. The one I went on tonight was up actually along Cemetery Hill where I'm staying. I'm just staying on the other side of it. And I found out a lot about Gettysburg history in addition to the ghost stories, including more detailed knowledge about right where the no man's land was here in town. I'm on Baltimore Street. My hotel is about that way, and Baltimore Street curves around the other side of Cemetery Hill. But Baltimore Street cuts over to Steinware back that way. And Steinware Avenue, the stripes on the road kind of literally are right on the line between where the Confederates and the Union forces were. That's how close the fighting was here. There were thousands of soldiers buried just 10 feet off the road mostly Confederate, but generally if they fell, they were buried right there. People's lives were impacted by this. It's a great action adventure story for us in one sense because it's 160 years ago. But if you're going to want a ghost tour, find ones that go into the humanity and the local details. Because, yeah, the ghost stories are fun, and there's a lot of, whether you believe in ghosts or not, there are a lot of phenomenon we just don't understand and can't explain. Some of us interpret it as ghosts. Others might interpret it a different way. Pardon the, there's a motorcycle coming by. But find a tour that talks, that gives you that local history. Because you'll find out a lot, whether you believe in ghosts or not. And those can be spooky fun anyway. But you'll find out a lot of local historical detail you'll never find out otherwise. But it is 2300. It's been a long day, although a very good one. I'm going to go home, take a shower again, and I'm going to bed. So good night, and I will see y'all tomorrow. So happy early 4th of July. Hello all, and happy Independence Day. It is the evening of July 4th, 2023, and the Battle of Gettysburg, of course, is over. 160 years ago today, it was a pouring rain out here, and Robert E. Lee used that very skillfully to pull his army out and start the long trek back to Virginia. Now, the Gettysburg Campaign, it was originally called the Pennsylvania Campaign, but of course it became known as the Gettysburg Campaign because the central battle of it is here. It is officially considered to end once Lee is across the Potomac back in Virginia, because he's got to get back through Maryland to Virginia. It was a pouring down rain. He had a wagon train that was between 14 and 17 miles long of wounded. That wasn't his supplies. That wasn't his munitions. That was his wounded. 14 to 17 miles long. His army would never be the same. And that's usually where we stop the story. However, our army would never be the same either. The Army of the Potomac, and more specifically General Meade, shattered forever the myth of invincibility. And in military terms, if you're, or political terms even, once the myth of invincibility is shattered, anything can happen. It'd take another 2 years, of course, for the Civil War to end. It wouldn't be until April 1865. And even then, that's when Robert E. Lee surrendered. Joseph Johnston, who was the last major Confederate commander, he surrendered to Sherman down in North Carolina after Lincoln's assassination. But Lee's surrender is not just a symbolic end to the Civil War. It's the practical end. Because once Lee had surrendered, even if Johnston had wanted to keep fighting, the inevitable was inevitable. The only option would have been to disperse and become guerrillas. And one reason Lee and Johnston and other Southern leaders rejected the option of becoming guerrillas is the fact was the South, their homeland, was devastated, decimated, damaged. Pick your term. A guerrilla war would be happening in the South where the conventional war had just been 4 years happening. It was a no-win situation. So Lee's surrender is the practical end of the war. The rest are the details that have to happen. Gettysburg by itself is not the turning point of the war for the Union. Gettysburg and Vicksburg together. Vicksburg was the Confederacy's last and greatest stronghold on the Mississippi. With Vicksburg, they bottlenecked Union commerce. We couldn't send our goods down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. And it also provided a secure connection for the East and Western theaters of the Confederacy. From Vicksburg south, while the Confederacy controlled Vicksburg, they had plenty of corridors to move men and supplies back and forth. While Ulysses Grant took Vicksburg on July 4th, 1863, 160 years ago today, General Meade defeated Robert E. Lee yesterday. Together, those are the turning point. The Confederacy's last and greatest stronghold connecting its two halves was captured by our forces in the West. The Confederacy's most powerfully political and prestigious army was defeated in the East. Now, it's easy for us here in 2023 to look back and say that those two together, those were the fulcrum point that the war turned on, because we have the hindsight to see that after that, except for the major Confederate victory at Chickamauga later in 1863, the Confederacy never recovered. And even the victory at Chickamauga was very short-lived because the Confederate commanders were not able to destroy the Union forces that were holed up in Chattanooga. So it was all downhill for the Confederacy from here out, from July 3rd and 4th, 1863. But again, for us, for the United States, it was all uphill in the sense of things getting better. But we can see that now very easily. They couldn't back then. They were still slogging it out. But they did slog it out. And the story ends, and yet, because it is history, because we can come in, we can walk these fields, we can see where they fought, we can stand where people lived, and we can find the exact spot sometimes where people died. It's a story we can keep alive. And it's a story we're actually living today. The Civil War was fought over slavery. Ultimately, that was the proximate and ultimate cause. But what's slavery? Slavery is a question of human freedom. After the Civil War, what did human freedom mean? Well, blacks were no longer slaves, but they weren't given the right to vote. We saw that turned out even after the 14th Amendment was passed. It took decades, if not a century, for that to be redressed. Women, though. Black women, white women, women weren't even allowed to vote until the 19th Amendment was passed. The Civil War was a question of human freedom. It's a question we're still wrestling with today. And one of the difficult things about human freedom is that you can give almost total, abject, utter, complete freedom to some, but never to all. Because if you give total, abject, complete freedom to some, they're going to be trampling over everybody else. So how do you balance? How do you find that balance between giving as much individual and social freedom as possible while maintaining a cohesive society that protects everybody's rights? That's a question humans have been wrestling with for thousands of years. We're not going to answer it in our lifetimes. Our children won't. But it's one that's still going on. And that way, we're not fighting the Civil War, per se. I reject that. I hear historians say that. We're still fighting the Civil War. Like, I reject that. But we're still fighting ourselves over the same questions. And we always will. That's part of human nature. Freedom is not the traditional human condition. For thousands and thousands of years, the human condition was slavery, dominant, you know, monarchy or, you know, royalty, you know, the noble few controlling the masses. We were and still are an incredible experiment in self-government. It's going to be interesting to see where Gettysburg is at Gettysburg's 200th anniversary in 2063. And assuming I'm still alive, I will be here for that. I have every intention to be, but that's quite a ways away. For now, though, I'm tired. I have been running myself ragged, not just to get my programming done, and I do it because I believe in it. I think there are great stories to tell, and I love to tell stories, but also there's a lot to see, and especially on an anniversary weekend like this. So I'm going to go shower, and I'm going to go to bed early, and then I am off to Mechanicsburg to see some friends tomorrow. It has been a good visit. I'm very glad I got here. This was a trip 10 years in the making. I promised myself back in 2013 I'd be here for this one, and I pulled it off. But all things, good and bad, must come to an end, and this has been a good thing, but the sun is setting literally on the day and figuratively on this particular trip. I'm going to take a shower, put my feet up, and just relax. Happy Independence Day. I will see you when I see you, and until then, go do some great things. Good morning once again. It is July 5th, 2023. I'm at Sachs Covered Bridge. It's a wooden covered bridge over Marsh Creek. It was completed in 1854, and elements of the Union Army tromped across it coming into the Battle of Gettysburg, and elements of the Confederate Army tromped across it getting the hell out of Dodge, and that would have been yesterday on July 4th. It has been a good trip. I've had a laugh at myself when I started when I started this format of programming, it was just to give some little updates here or there until I got home to Florida and did all the big things. And I looked at what I did yesterday and realized, holy crap, those are whole freaking episodes. So I still have some travelogue stuff to do when I get back to Florida, but I realized I told a whole lot more of the story than I thought I did. And that's not a bad thing. I think I actually enjoy this kind of programming too. Not to get rid of the studio stuff whatsoever, but I think this is going to be fun to add to my repertoire. But it's been a good trip. I said this was a trip 10 years in the making and 2 years in the planning. So I'm heading out. I'm going actually up to Mechanicsburg to see my friends Jerry and Michelle. And if any of you are familiar with the accidental detective mystery novels that I write, Jerry is actually my editor and coach. We were in the Navy together. He was my chief, and then I made chief, and he was my mentor. And now we describe ourselves as the best of enemies and mortal friends. I hope I told some good stories that kept you entertained, and of course, I will see you on the flip side back in Florida. Until then, be safe, have a great July, and go and do great things.